Last person I'm talking to, so you probably get the best interview, darling, don't I?
The way I look at myself, if I ever do, is as I'm a man of extremes, and I think every character is made up of a load of ingredients, and I just think I have a very soft side and a very hard side. But I will say one thing is that I think I am a man of extremes, but I don't feel I have that much in the middle, which is you either get me where I'm very strong, I'm very soft. So if the right person gets me, they'll find me that I'm very vulnerable and I can be a real baby if they find me the right time. At the same time, I'm very strong and very hard, and there's no half measures with me. In the end, all the mistakes and all the excuses are down to me. I like to feel that I'm just being my honest self. And as far as I'm concerned, I just want to pack in as much of life and fun, having a good time, as much as I can. Well, there you are, you have it on tape. Yeah. Use it. Well, it's the nearest I've come to a lot of passion in terms of interviews. How much more have you got now? Come on, I'm getting bored.
Hi, my name's Kim Battinger. I'm Freddie Mercury.
Oh, yes, I'm the great pretender. Pretending I'm doing well.
This guy, Freddie?
In one lifetime? Impossible.
I pretend too much. I'm lonely.
Full of surprises and lots of creative ideas.
Oh, yes, I'm the great pretender.
It's inspiring to work with. He's always been a tower of energy, really.
I play the game, but to my real shame.
This is the most stimulating person to work with you could ever meet. I mean, he's just always off on a different tack from what you expect.
Conceal.
It's a one-off, you know. You don't get too many people like him.
If you're watching, Freddie.
Like a clown.
Very impatient, yeah. He sort of knew he was where he was going, and he just wanted to get there quicker than the world was going to allow it.
I'm wearing my heart like a clown.
Quite simply, he was one of the most important figures in rock and roll over the last 20 years.
Pretty sweet guy, yeah. Great voice.
But Freddie, I think, had the edge. He was a born showman.
The 80s, he does piano.
Anything you want to know about performance, you just look at Freddie and he answers all your questions.
Like a clown.
King Mercury.
His creations as musical composers were
best rock and roll singers that I know of all time.
To me, he's one of the last of the real rock stars.
One of the great things about Fred was his horizons were limitless, you know, artistically.
Most of the stuff I do is pretending. It's like acting, you know, so you go on stage and I pretend to be a macho man and all that. And then in my videos, you know, you go through all the different characters and then you're pretending anyway. So I think it's a great title for what I do, and it sort of suited to what I was doing. I mean, although the meaning in the song of how it was, is all to do with love, that he's pretending about love, but I mean, I sort of take it a stage further, I think, you know. The way I see it is that I'm pretending, you know, that all this is a pretense, you know, and it's just fun. I'm just a musical prostitute, my dear. If I didn't do this, I don't have anything to do. You know, I can't cook. I'm not very good at being a housewife. I'm just very frivolous, and I like to enjoy myself, and
what better way to do it than on stage in front of 300,000 people, you know?
Ups and downs, and we all have our limitations, and we all know that there's certain things you can't do. But I mean, I don't want some asshole critic to tell me that. Try to do this every day, forget it.
Thank you, good evening, all you rock and rollers. And welcome to our carnival.
How prolific a writer are you?
Oh, I write a dozen a day.
does it come easy?
It can, if I put my mind to it, yes. I mean I'm not sort of blowing my own trumpet, but... I do churn them up quite quickly, far quicker than the others, I think. They know that. But,
what are the ideal sort of set of circumstances for you when you're writing?
I have to be alone. I just have to be left alone, locked up, and I just sort of concentrate.
Okay, before we tease you with a bit of sort of heavy rock and roll and things towards the end, I'd just like to slip in a little, I'd like you to listen carefully to a simple little song. This is a... me on the piano, it's called You Take My Breath Away.
Well, when I see myself, oh dear, I wouldn't tear them all up. I just think, I actually laugh at myself. Oh my God, did I really look like that? When I was going through college, I mean, I was very interested in music, so I joined other bands and I got to know Brian and Roger. I realized that through college, I spent more time, you know, giving more time to rehearsing our songs and things than doing the other thing. At that time, you know, no matter who you are, whatever you do, I mean, your interests just pull you towards that. And then I realized that the moment I finished that and I finished college, my interests were in music. All I wanted to do was music. So I set upon the fact that, oh, no, I'm going to try and make it as a singer. When you first start up, because you think, oh, I've done that, let's go there. So when you're climbing, when you're going up, it's, you know, the escalator is going up. And once you go up there, it's sort of like you tread up, you keep treading at the top because you don't want to go down. I can make a bigger bang than that, dear. I'll tell you. I would give up all my life for just one kiss. I would surely die if you dismiss me from your love. You take my breath away. And I looked ridiculous then, but it worked.
What is left of your dream? Just the words on your stone. Man who learned how to teach, but forgot how to love.
At that time, nobody looked like him. Nobody sang like him with the harmonies and everything.
Yeah, yeah, oh, yeah, oh, yeah.
You know, he was a total one-off.
Oh, oh, oh. but can you hear me?
And I was absolutely gobsmacked. But also the look, because Freddie always had a unique look about him. He just couldn't take your eyes off his face. He had one of those faces.
Out comes this guy in a leotard. And as a good American, I said, oh my God, what's this? I mean, it was...
Yeah, they went over the top a few times. Alarming lapses of taste.
As Elton told me yet again, he said, oh God, you won't believe this character. He says, if he doesn't like what the audience is doing, he tells them to fuck off. And gets away with it.
Well, yes, things change. At the beginning, I think he probably was a bit of a diva, probably.
He was very interesting. He was very open, very warm.
The thing that impressed me most about Freddie was the amount of power he had, and just basic lung power.
First thing you have to do as a vocalist is realize that you'll never be able to sing like Freddie.
Freddie Mercury probably got the best voice, one of the five best voice in the world. Listen to the madness, listen to the madness, listen to the madness, listen to the madness.
What was the question?
He said to me, you'd always wanted to be a dancer.
I mean, to say that I'm very well equipped in ballet dancing is totally wrong. I mean, I just sort of, it's mock ballet, you know, and I know it was sort of like, at that time, to actually sort of introduce a certain kind of balletic look into rock and roll was sort of, it was sort of outrageous. And I thought, how, you know, what's a real funky rock and roll audience going to say to this prancing ballerina coming.
Right.
I thought, fine, I'll sing my rock and roll songs with a tutu on, I don't care.
Mama just killed a man, put a gun against his head, pulled my trigger, now he's dead. Mama, life had just begun.
I did a charity show with the Royal Ballet. They asked me, and I couldn't believe it, they asked me. And it was worth doing. It was like, I put a little bit of rock and roll into the ballet.
The funny thing is that when we started working on, when we were doing the gala with Bohemian Rhapsody, I said, well, I'll choreograph for you. Because he was very keen, and he came in his ballet shoes, and he was all ready to go. And what I found was that when I tried to choreograph things for him, he was completely spastic almost. You to turn this way and put your arm this way and do that. And he didn't relate to him at all. But then if you just said, do whatever you want, he would be incredible. So his I think that most of all it was just instinctive and totally natural. Goodbye, everybody. I've got to go. Gotta leave you all behind. Liked it, you know. I mean, part of the rock syndrome is the shock, anyway, isn't it? So for him, it was. I think he enjoyed the fact that it was so different.
It was totally on a different stage with a different audience, and I had to sort of actually deal with the Royal Ballet. So I mean, so it's nice to actually be able to, and I could feel that the same song could be put across in a different way, and it could be accepted.
Had him tipped upside down so he could sing upside down. He thought that would impress. Who do you think it was going to impress? Somebody, David Bowie, I think. This will get him.
Ballad dancer, I'd be terrible. But I can kick my legs up real high.
Funny thing is, when I approached Freddie to sing on the Time concept album, I wanted him to do a song called In My Defense, and so I went to Munich and met him, and he listened to the song, he loved it, and he liked the idea of appearing with Laurence Olivier and Stevie Wonder and people like that. But the most important thing was the song he liked. He said, but how do you see me doing it? And I said to him, well, I see it as a cross between Edith Piaf, Judy Garland, and Shirley Bassey. He said, my dear, I have all the frocks, so I'll do it.
I took this project knowing fully well that he was the overseer, but of course I wanted to put my sort of stamp on it. And then in the end we disagreed on a lot of elements, but then like he gave way and I gave way to a lot of things.
Playback, please, in the photo, without spotlight. Right, okay, wait a second. New Cue Barry is the first piano break in A. Start from the piano break in A.
Back the time is running out for us all.
I think people think that I'm a real, it starts with C, but I can't think of anything. But I'm a cherub. But I mean, sometimes you have to give way to sort of understand certain problems, you know. But I mean, I'm very hard to deal with, yes.
I want you to sit close up now. Because Freddie's acting that much up.
The reason I wanted Freddie to work on the project, and I was knocked out that he did it, was because I wanted Freddie to give it his special element. And I think that's, it's pointless getting involved with any other artist and taking away what has attracted you to want them in the project.
Time waits for nobody. We'll have no more future at all. Time waits for nobody.
The way I see it, okay, is the way that there are certain elements in this musical that have never been done before. See, I'm one of these commercial streaks, you know, people that love that. So, as far as I'm concerned, I mean, you could sing a song backwards and wear all kinds of wonderful clothes, but if there's an element of surprise or something that has never been done before, that brings me to a theatre. Laurence Olivier's face was, even to this day, I mean, I'm talking to people and you read about in the press, they don't know how it's done or whatever, is an enigma, which I love to sort of, it's something that brings you there, the mystique and all that.
Yeah.
That's, to me, that is theatre.
About being on the album of Time, people like Cliff Richard, Stevie Wonder, Freddie Mercury, Dionne Warwick, Julian Lennon, and Dave Clark as well. Very strange company for you.
Absolutely thrilled.
Olivier is just magic. I mean, you know, just when you hear his voice, he just wants to put a song next to it.
earlier on, I went through art college, you know, and I was going to be a graphics. I mean, I went and did my diploma in graphics illustration, so I was going to be a graphics illustrator, you know. I was just, obviously, I can paint and do that.
Fred had style. In everything he did, he had style.
One point was acknowledged as having the largest collection of antique Japanese prints in Britain, but that was long gone now. I mean, that was, you know, years and years ago. His taste in art changed throughout the years. He'd go through a period where he loved Dali, for example, and he'd see what he could find with Dali, Dali, Dali.
One day I went to buy a clock from Sotheby's. I hadn't seen anything. He'd gone to view. He just sent me along with the lot number and the catalogue and said, this is what I want to buy. There was a few things. And this one clock I will never forget. And these wonderful clocks were coming around. And I said, oh, this looks great. And suddenly this clock came on and it was the most disheveled looking clock. I thought, what the hell does he want this for?
Slot number 204, £350 is off. 350, 380, 400, thank you, sir. £400, any more?
So I bid and I got the clock and I brought it home and I said, well, there's your clock. And I said, but why? Why this one? Ah, he said, you wait till I finish with it. And when it came back, it was... it's like magic. The whole thing had changed. He'd looked at the clock, saw the potential, bought it, had it regilded, and it was alive again. That was the man. He loved beauty.
Yeah, it redefined the word party, I think.
First one I've been invited to. No one invites me to parties.
Trolls and dwarves and ogres and thieves and ballerinas and transvestites and transsexuals, and I think there's two or three people of the third sex there, which I couldn't really understand. I wound up in flagrante delicto under the catering table. Were you there?
No.
They had a dwarf covered in liver. You don't know about this?
No.
Oh, no, there was a dwarf covered in liver. And he laid there on a platter like this. And whenever anybody dug this dull knife into him, he would go like that. And the whole plate of liver would quiver, like pate kind of thing. So it was like a moving pâté pastiche.
Ah!
We had 1 week just for thinking in black and white. The ashtrays, the flowers, everything.
Be on a Fellini set.
Let's turn it on, yeah. Nobody's giving it up, yeah. Everybody's living it up, yeah. Everybody's living it up, living let's it turn up. It on, yeah. Nobody's giving it up. Everybody's living it up, yeah, yeah. Everybody's living it up.
And he spent his money, what he got, for himself, but not on the first thing, for others. Let him have fun. Because I only have fun if I can give and see that, that I can make other people have whatever it is.
Dancing, 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 dancing. Turn it on and get everybody happy. Let's turn it on. Let's make everybody happy.
I live life to the full, wow.
Let's turn it on, come on, all you happy people together. Turn it on, yeah.
Every day is flashing for me. Solo projects. I mean, you're your own boss and everything. And it's. I find that, that when I'm my own boss completely, then it's just it's easier for me. I make all the decisions. They're harder sometimes.
He was absolutely genius.
Well, Matt is an absolute genius.
I mean, I told him that many times, you're a genius, and he said...
He's absolute genius.
No, I just do it. Usually took him maybe 15, 20 minutes to come up with something absolutely brilliant.
There must be more to life, much more to life. There must be more to life, more to life than this.
The actual execution of doing something, seeing it through to the end, that was a little harder for him.
I like to capture a song very quickly so that it's fresh, and then you can work on it afterwards.
Because once he had the idea, it was basically finished for him.
It either comes quickly, and then you have it, you know, like the basic skeleton, and then I say, yes, we have a song, and now then we can start putting in all the clever bits. Mm-hmm.
Okay, it's the wrong part. You brought me into the first.
Yeah.
Rhythm, one man, one self, one God, rhythm. Oh, oh, oh.
Well, Fred didn't really wanted nobody else around while he was singing, but at the same time he was literally attacking the microphone just to get what he wanted, or running up to the mic to hit certain high notes.
But if a song's not happening, I normally just say, oh, forget it, let's try something else.
Which track are we going now? The first track?
Yes, do the first track first.
One God, one religion. One man, one self, one God, religion. One man, one self, one God, religion. Whoa, whoa, whoa.
He always told me Munich is like Disneyland.
But yeah, he was going out, he felt free, like one from the street, like everybody, you know. He had wonderful times, oh my God. Sometimes I had to watch him, you know, he sent it back, he's the bodyguard. Said, oh, I have Barbara, you're home, and the rest, Barbara takes care of me, you know.
I'm not scared of doing what I want to do. Before I sort of hide in my past, so like when I went out, I had to sort of try and perform a little as well and say, like, not letting them down and the thing like, because Freddie Mercury, I don't know what it means, but he had to react in a certain way, what the press had told people. And a lot of times I used to do that so that I was actually living, in a way, living a false image of myself, you know, and now I'm not worried, so I mean, if I make a fool of myself, you know, if I fall into a dustbin, which I have many times, I don't worry about the fact that, and so I'm having a good time, you know.
There must be more to life, much more to life. There must be more to life, more to life than
he was trying. I think he was around 1 year in Munich to find the Freddie Mercury solo album sound.
So ask me about my solo album then, huh?
Yeah, what about your solo album?
Oh, it's great.
I'm taking my ride with destiny, willing to play my part. Living with painful memories, loving with all my heart. Made in heaven, made in heaven. It was all meant to be. Yeah, made in heaven.
You could call it an ego trip, you could call it going off on a tangent, you could call it something I just want to do. You could call it anything. It's just basically, it's just a batch of songs that and I want to do it my, you know, my way. I sound like Frank Sinatra.
That's why they say, can't you see? That's what everybody says to me. Can't you see? Oh,
I have arranged that sort of depending on what mood I'm in, it just goes up and down. I use the Demis Roussos method. You know, you get a pair of pliers under the frock and go.
Yes, it's really meant to be.
as far as I was concerned, all Queen albums were little solo projects anyway. I was writing my kind of songs that I wanted. But now I think the time has come where I want a whole album of my own, and Roger's done two already, so I think most people thought that I would be the first one to have a solo album, and then the band would, you know, Queen would break up and all that.
I'm having to learn to pay the price. They're turning me upside down. Waiting for possibilities. Don't see too many around. Made in heaven. Yeah, made in heaven. It's for all to see. Made in heaven. Made in heaven.
This is going to sort of form a mini film in the end with lots of other videos from my solo album.
I was born to take care of you every single day of my life. I want to love you.
And that's what I do every night. Basically, it's just a romp through my house.
I want to love you, love you, love you.
I don't like to write message songs because I'm not sort of politically orientated. I'm not like a John Lennon or a Stevie Wonder. I just feel that I like, my songs are just basically commercial love songs, and I like to put my emotional talents into that. I'm aware of what goes on, but I still write a song the way I feel it. And if it means that the song that I like needs something that's old-fashioned, I will still do it. Because, I mean, I never let the song down. I mean, the song comes first. I love to write songs about something totally different, but they all seem to end up in a very emotional and tragic way. I don't know, maybe I'm a very tragic person, I don't know why.
With every single beat of my heart.
Yes, sir.
Take.
Yeah, give it rock and roll. All right.
Okay, we got speed on
okay,
the camera.
Here we go, please. And playback.
They're
trying to get tight.
Right.
Words, yeah? And then into the camera.
Right.
Yep. All right, here we go.
Well, we
I wanted to show people that all these different roles that I was doing in video was a kind of pretense, that I was pretending. And to bring them back, I had to sort of choose key roles that I did in the past and then to try and marry them with the word pretender and things like that.
Captain Pregnancy.
Yes, sir. Where, do I have tights then,
sorry,
Dario?
Sorry, don't
carry on.
I've shaved my chest as well.
What's my tip?
I got you have.
No, but for shot, I think we'll have to make sure that it sort of does at least that, so you can see through a bit.
Give her tips.
Well, we just put the pattern in rather than the whole thing. Ah!
That's horny.
Yes.
You got it.
Now, I think with the green dress, what do you think?
Oh, yes, yes.
Well, see, then it's got red, black, green.
No, I think black is right because it's black.
Well, according to the girls, you've got to put your forward. Sorry. And your tits erect, and you've got to walk.
That's it.
Honey. You
think
that's
you've been around.
Do you change your costume and you become somebody else?
Go see what the boys in the back room will have.
My costume.
I'm Jane Mansfield. Do you think it's me? God, you girls have all the fun, I tell you. Five. I'm being shaved from nipples above.
I would say
that's perfect. Oh, I'm naked.
I look beautiful.
You can't see it. James. Wow, I feel.
That's it. Oh, yes, motherfuckers.
Let's go.
Oh, yes, I know. I look very glamorous tonight, don't I?
Oh, yes, I'm the
go by my own experiences. When I go on stage, I'm acting out a certain role. I mean, I'm when I come off it, I mean, I don't carry on that way, otherwise I'd be dead. I mean, I'm, you know. So it's like a pretense, you know.
It's the best industry to be in, you know. You can get rich and all that, and you have a wonderful time, but it's very, very hard work.
I've paid my dues time after time. I've done my sentence, but committed no crime. And bad mistakes, I've made a few. I've had my share of bad kicks in my.
Classics will always remain. Because that's a winner's song, you know, which keeps coming back. I can't believe that somebody else hasn't written another song to take it over, you know.
We are the champions. We are the champions. No time for losing. Because we are the champions of the world.
It's quite easy to say you know, you did it 10 years ago and you can do the same old thing again. I hate doing the same things again. I like to see what's happening now. In terms of video now, I like to have fun in them because I think if you do that, it comes across, and then you know people can relate to that. And basically, it's just me having fun. And so I can't, you know, I can't just sit in a chair and knit a blouse or whatever. I mean, it's just I've got to go through all these horrible sort of scenes and things, which is what I'm all about.
So then, what I do. So that's your position.
Why don't you?
I'm crawling after I've done your sort of thing. I come and sit down here next to Roger, who's sitting here. So Roger sits here. And then you can just sit down. What's the reaction? Then I have to move across.
And then front. And go to you.
Sit.
Yeah.
You see, because then the. And you can keep playing to the whole take like that. And then I'll just come over.
And you were the idea was
anything.
Back to Freddie and you
yeah,
were
end up. Yeah, we'll end up like that.
And I know I can stop doing that and just live on my money, but I'm not that kind of person. I want to work because, I mean, I get so bored, you know, I'd be so bored.
Oh! How long have we got? 5 minutes? 5, 10 minutes?
The way I live is that I have to be doing something every day. I want to earn my keep, and I want to be doing something. I have a nervous energy that needs to be doing something. I'm sort of very reluctant to actually go on tour because it takes me a long time to actually get into this physical. It's very, very exhausting for me to do what I have to do. It's hard work, but it's very rewarding, of course. That's what you're saying, is that once you go on stage and when, you know, when they like you, of course, that's a beautiful feeling.
Tonight, I'm gonna have myself a real good time. I feel alive.
We were just performers, and there's a lot of theatre in our music as well. So I think whenever we go on stage, I mean, it's a lot of theatre. I mean, I like to ham it up, you know. I like to sort of really perform a song.
'Cause I'm having a good time, having a good time. Don't stop me now. I'm having such a good time. I'm having a ball. Don't stop me now. If you wanna have a good time, just give me a call.
My stage persona. I mean, that's the only way I like to do it on stage. But that doesn't mean that I go around wearing the same clothes. But I still like to have a good time off stage as well. You know, I can sort of. But oh no, I mean, I think most of the time it's like I leave that face back of the stage.
Not enough.
Do they have enough servants' quarters?
Not a good thing to say in this country.
Everybody looks at me on stage and they think that's how I am, like arrogant, and you know, that's the way I am. No, and when you look at me now, no, I'm quite boring, really.
No, sorry, I didn't say that. I'd like to feel that after all these years, I'm myself at every given point. When I'm on stage, that's Freddie Mercury. When I'm off stage, I'm Freddie Mercury. And that's the only way to be. I mean, the days have gone where I actually felt that when I was on stage, when I came off, I still had to sort of portray that Freddie Mercury image because of other people.
He phoned me up in a great state of excitement one night and he said, "You never guess what? I've had a message to say that Montserrat Caballé would like to meet me." And he said, "I'm not going without you."
The meeting was arranged for 2 o'clock. Freddie's inside, pacing up and down, up and down, all done up. Wonderful suit, looking really good. So I had to keep an eye out at the door to see when anyone was coming. And about 2:15, you could see people in the foyer just sort of parting as Montserrat and her party came walking in.
It is the room where we first met. When I entered the room, he was so cold in his hands. I was very cold too.
but I could feel his cold hands, and I thought he's cooler than me. See, he's nervous too, so that's good, because when the people are nervous, that means both are expecting something from the other one.
They sat down, Freddie and Montserrat were sitting together, and all the rest of us were around, and for about 2 or 3 minutes, there was just sort of silence. And then Freddie turned to Montserrat and said, "Well, I've got a song for you, shall I play it?" And that was it. That broke the ice.
A piano was in the corner, well prepared, so we stand up from the table and we went to the corner, and he was playing, and I was beginning to sing. We could go on for hours and hours and hours. So when we finished, we look at each other, and I knew it, that he has conquered me.
Viva!
He was on cloud nine. Freddie was up in the sky. He didn't need a plane to go home. He really was so happy.
And I just thought, maybe one song or a duet, and that's. And she said things like, "Only one song? Are you sure? You only want to do one song?" And I said, "Well, let's see how we get on. You know, if you like more of my music." And she said, "How many songs does a normal rock and roll album have?" And I said something like 10. "Oh, we'll do 10 songs then." So, so she just said, "Yes, write 10 songs, like tomorrow."
Was an example of the high musicality of Freddie. It was not only a pop rock singer, it was a musician that could sit on the piano and could compose for me.
It's such a challenge, actually. It's, that's going to be great, because I've never sort of thought of writing songs in that way. Now, she said she wants to do duets with me, I have to sort of think in a totally different way.
I had this perfect dream.
When you met me,
this dream was me and you. I want all the world to see. Miracle sensation, my guiding inspiration.
From what I know of Freddie, one of the biggest, greatest moments in his life was when Montserrat had come over and actually put down her vocal track for Barcelona. Because I remember him turning around to me and saying, after they'd done it, going home from the studio, he just said, "That's it, I've done it. I've got her voice on my music."
A new way to do music together towards the classic, or the classic towards them. It was the first and only person that has done this.
Fred saying to me, he said, "I can't go on stage and do my usual, this, because, he's singing, maybe I better tone down the act a bit, And, of course, what he'd temporarily forgotten was this was an operatic diva. When she went on stage, she was like a bloody volcano. She just went, "Wah!" And as soon as she started, he looked over at me and thought, "Bloody hell, I've got competition here." And it was actually quite a fiery combination.
Such a beautiful horizon. For him it was normal, but for me, no.
And I told him, Freddie, listen, do you think really I have to perform with you? I don't feel like I am old, I am big, I don't know. And he says, listen, music has not aged.
Don't be ridiculous.
I love my job, but I hate talking to people like you.
Thanks.
No, do you mean that? I love it right now because I said earlier on, you're the last person I'm talking to, so you probably get the best interview, darling, don't I?
Oh, that said something, isn't it?
Just get on with it.
To me, happiness is the most important thing. And if I'm happy, then it shows in my work. And so basically, I just want to be happy and make a lot of money and buy a lot of things.
The money. I don't want to change the world. I don't want to talk about peace or any kind of sort of political content because I just don't feel I'm motivated that way. I can't go and do things that somebody else tells me, like, okay, do this. I just can't sort of categorically just go and say, okay, yeah, that's right. I have to feel myself and make sure that I'm doing the right thing because in the end, all the mistakes and all the excuses are down to me, you know. I can't pass the buck. But you have to have a certain amount of arrogance and that ego and whatever, because you have to believe in what you do.
I don't know, I'm just me, you know, I'm just me.
I like to feel that I'm just being my honest self and I don't give a shit about what other people say.
I'm a man of extremes, you know, so I sort of change from day to day, you know, like a chameleon.
I'm a true romantic, yeah, just like Rudolph Valentino.
As long as it's not Lee Van Cleef. And in fact, quite a lot of people, when they meet me, they're quite disillusioned. The fact that they expect me to actually just do what I do on stage. And I'm a human being, you know, and I'd like people to realize the fact that I'm a human being.
I think in the end, being natural and being actually genuine is what wins.
I'm being very modest, but very true.
How much more have you got now? Come on, I'm getting bored.
Oh, that doesn't matter. I mean, you know,
that's the least of his problems, I should think, you know.
On stage, I'm very powerful. On stage, I'm powerful. I'm a bad guy on stage, yeah.
We all have a role to play.
I don't worry about my age at all, because I know I look beautiful, anyway.
I don't look too bad for 37, I'll tell you.
I'm 38. It takes 2 years to get to 40.
There you are, then.
Why should anybody worry about age? Because there's nothing to do about it. You can't get younger.
What do you think?
And as far as I'm concerned, I mean, I just want to pack in as much of life and fun and having a good time as much as I can within the years I have.
When they stop buying our records, then I'll say goodbye and do something else, become a strip artist or something.
You understood that, huh?
So what music you would strip? What music would you use?
All the songs I've written! Like, come on!
Well, there you are, you have it on tape. Yeah. Use it. I don't wake up every morning and say, oh, look, have I dried up, you know? It's just, at the moment, you know, I'm being very prolific and, he's looking after me. Life goes on.
When that happens, it won't happen. That's all there is to it, you know, I'm thinking about it. There you go.
I don't think it'll ever happen. I'll die first. Well, it's the nearest I've come to a lot of passion in terms of interviews.
What do you think?
Maybe you cut, and suddenly you go from one to the other, and I think you make a good compilation. That's it.
don't leave. You've stolen my love. Now deserve
And Freddie was not an immoral person. Freddie was not a promiscuous person. He was a person who moved from relationship to relationship, as many of us do, struggling to find the right one. But it only needs one of those contacts, or it only needs one night, and a thing can happen, you know.
Freddie put a very brave face on things. He didn't want to bother other people with his problems, even including those nearest to him. And then it became very apparent that he was very ill. But then, even then, there is a disinclination to believe the terrible truth. And then at one point he decided to just sort of invite us all over to the house for a meeting. And he just sort of told us, you know, the absolute facts, the facts that we were really starting to realize anyway. And really that produced a coming together, a closing of the ranks. And we wanted to protect then his privacy as much as possible. And also to enable him to work and to keep his mind off, you know, off the awful realities. And which is really what he wanted. And that's that really did help him a lot towards the end, yeah.
Freddie was all about living, and I think when it got to the time he did disclose, it was because he was ready and prepared to die, and I think that tells a story about the man too, that he would only tell the world when he accepted that that was going to happen to him, but for the years prior, that wasn't the case. It was something that a burden he carried. But he fought, and he lived, he wrote, he produced with you videos. He was all about living, he wasn't about death.
It's hard, that one, because, I mean, nobody expects it to happen. And I was there on my own, and Freddie just smiled and went to sleep.
The 45-year-old lead singer of Queen died peacefully at his home in London.
Fans and friends in paying tribute to the singer Freddie Mercury, who died late last night from AIDS.
At midnight, it was announced that Freddie Mercury had died peacefully at his London home.
Dedicated to their lead singer Freddie Mercury, who died last night of AIDS.
He died on Sunday after revealing that he was suffering from AIDS.
A 45-year-old Queen singer who died yesterday, a bronchial pneumonia brought on by AIDS.
His spokesman said he died peacefully last night at his hospital.
Meanwhile, fans from across the country are expected to come here to Freddie Mercury's home to pay their tributes to a man regarded as one of the best in the business. Thank you.
I did all the arrangements for it, the funeral, because we'd spent so many years making him look presentable before he left the house. You know, making sure that his tie was straight, making sure he looked so good, that it was the last thing that I could do for his last leaving, was just to make everything as perfect as possibly could. C'est la vie.
My face, what is there to say? All the mistakes we made must be faced today. It's not easy now, knowing where to start, while the world we love tears itself apart.
A very loving person, you know. How about that?
In my defense, what is better said? We destroy the love, it's our way. We never listen enough, never face the truth. And like a passing song,
do it all over again? Yes, why not? Why not? I do it slightly differently.
I still love you.
Thank you, God bless you, sweet dreams, you lot of tarts. Goodbye.